business on BCTV is brought to you by Hervine and Company Incorporated, certified public accountants, accounting for success.
Hello and welcome to Berks Business. I'm Bob Wirt, Managing Director for Investments of the Wirt Investment Consulting Group of Wachovia Securities. Each month on Berks Business, we give you the opportunity to meet the leaders of the local business community and give you the opportunity to ask questions during our live presentation on Monday night. You can call us at 610-378-0426 if you have questions for our guests. Our guest tonight is Mr. Eric Fabrizio of Bingham & Hess. Eric, welcome to the program.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you for having me.
Well, let's kind of get right into it. Tell us about Bingham & Hess. What do you do there?
Bingham & Hess is a full-service law firm. We have history in the community going back, I believe, to the late 1800s. We have 14 lawyers. We can handle pretty much any legal issue that comes through the door. My concentration is mainly on estate planning, tax planning, representing trusts, and I do some family law work, which, believe it or not, does tie into estate planning on a number of occasions.
Sure it does. Well, what is estate planning?
Well, estate planning is what you want to do while you're alive to set up what happens with your assets after you pass away. And you do that through a will. There is also, what also falls under the category of estate planning are things like powers of attorney and healthcare powers of attorney, which are documents that actually are in effect while you are alive. The will doesn't come into play until you pass away, but the other two documents are for when you're living.
Okay, so the power of attorney passes away when you do.
Correct.
And then the will takes effect at that point.
And why it's important to have a power of attorney is if something happens to you while you're alive, it's when you would designate someone to act on your behalf with regard to your finances, your retirement accounts, your home, paying your bills. And contrary to popular belief, powers of attorney generally do not come into effect when you're incompetent. Mm-hmm. They come into effect as soon as your agent, and that's the person you're choosing to make decisions for you, signs it. And it's a very powerful document, and you really have to have someone you trust be your agent. And then there's also the healthcare power of attorney, which that doesn't take effect until you're unable to communicate your own medical decisions. And this used to be called the living will. In the last few years, they've expanded it to include situations where you're not, for lack of a better term, close to death and would pass away. Certain measures weren't taken, but also if you're incompetent for reasons such as Alzheimer's, dementia, things like that, where you're nominating someone as your healthcare agent to say, yes, do this medical procedure, don't do that one, admit me into this facility. And it's really something everyone should have, the healthcare power of attorney.
Now, if you're married, does that marriage count as the healthcare power of attorney, or do you need an explicit document?
No, it does not. And it's a good question, because a lot of people are under the misconception that, well, I don't need these documents because I'm married. That's not the case. You need to put it in writing who you want to handle, who you want to be your agent for your financial affairs, as well as healthcare. And by not doing that, you're subjecting yourself to a process known as guardianship, which could take several months, cost several thousands of dollars, and in fact lead to court fights between your loved ones who may just have different opinions as to what's best for you. And in order to stop that, to save a lot of money and a lot of emotional heartbreak, you really need to sit down with your family, with your attorney, and decide, who do I want to be my agent? Who do I want to be my healthcare agent? Doesn't have to be the same person.
What does the hospital do if you're in an emergency situation and there's only one person there to make decisions that may or may not have power?
Well, if it's an emergency situation, they're going to do whatever they can to help you. After that's taken care of, and hopefully it is, if you're still unable to make those decisions, they will ask, does this person have the healthcare power of attorney? Obviously, the first person the hospital is likely going to go to is the spouse.
Right.
If there's no spouse, then they're going to go to the children. And hopefully, you've made provisions that if your spouse passes away, who would be your, quote, backup? Who's next in line to take over? And that's another point to make. Whenever you're doing these documents, it always helps if you name someone as your backup in case there's what we call a common disaster where the spouses are in an accident, injured, and can't make decisions for the other, or if the one spouse predeceases the other.
Right. Well, how often should you look at these kind of documents?
We recommend that you look at them every year. Now, that's not to say that every year they're going to change, because they're not. But every year, as you should be doing as your financial advisor, when you go in for your, quote, financial checkup, you should always just take a look at the estate documents, see if anything's changed, if your wishes have changed. Whenever there's a major life event, be it a marriage, birth of a child, the passing away of a spouse, that's when you should really revisit your estate plan. And I know there are a lot of people out there who don't have estate plans, even with small children.
Right.
They don't have wills. And even if you don't have a lot of assets, or don't think you do, if you have a child under the age of 18, you need to have a will so you and your spouse could let really the world know, who is going to take care of my child if neither of us are here?
Right.
Because that could lead to some pretty bad court fights, and psychologically it's hard for people to do. Look, nobody wants to think about this stuff. It's not pleasant.
Mm-mm.
Nobody is happy to come in and talk to me about what's going to happen when I die. But if you don't do it now, you're just asking for trouble later.
Right.
Potentially a lot of trouble. If you have a child and the grandparents are fighting over the child, aunts and uncles, it's just not a good situation.
Exactly. So if you look at the things like a will and a power of attorney, you need a will when you have children. You need a will when you have property. Any other circumstances that you want to...
I mean, that pretty much covers it. What a will does is it's where you set forth who you want to receive your assets after your death.
Right.
And it's really that simple. But what a lot of people don't understand or aren't aware of is that the will does not dispose of all of your property.
Right.
For example, I know you have a lot of clients with retirement plans, 401s, IRAs, and even life insurance policies.
Mm-hmm.
Generally, those assets do not pass under your will. They pass by virtue of the beneficiary designation forms you set forth when you open the account. And a common situation is a lot of people, when they first get a job, they'll write down a spouse, and if they don't have children, they'll name brother or sister. Then when they have a child,
yes,
the spouse, the couple will come in there, get their wills done, make sure everything is set up for the child, who takes care of the child gets the money, what it's used for, but they never take a look at the beneficiary designations on the IRAs, the life insurance, and their retirement accounts. And what happens then if, God forbid, there's a common disaster, the child's not getting that money,
mm-hmm.
the brother, the aunt, the uncle, the parent.
Right, exactly.
And that's not to say that the person's not going to give the money to the child, but you're running into a lot of tax consequences that are just generally avoided. So in addition to taking a look at your will, what you need to do is really keep on top of your beneficiary designations for IRAs and 401s. Another issue that comes into play with estate planning is how your assets are titled. If your assets are titled jointly with, be it a spouse, a child, anybody, whatever is in your will really doesn't matter. Now, there's some court cases out there that have put that into a little bit of flux that we're still waiting on.
Right.
But a lot of people, for convenience reasons, will put a joint owner on an account, a bank account, a CD, anything like that, not realizing that by doing so, when they die, that money is not even going to go through their will and the people they have named.
Right.
It's going to the joint account holder, in some cases 100%, and that person does not have to give the money back. And you may end up with heirs paying inheritance taxes on money they're never getting.
So if you had a joint bank account for $500,000, you put you have yourself and you put your child on there,
right?
And you have another $100,000 in your estate.
Sure.
The joint account would pass to the child at your death. The $100,000 in the estate
would get split among your other children. So let's assume you have two kids.
Right.
Those two kids are going to split $100,000. They're each going to get $50,000, but the one child who is joined on that $500,000 is going to get the rest.
Yes.
And a lot of times that's not what the person intended to do, but they figured, oh, well, it will just be easier if I put somebody else, child, on the account.
Right.
And it's not only for the parent. That could be problematic for the child as well. If there's a divorce, that money suddenly becomes part of a divorce settlement. If that child dies, that money is, at least half of it's going to get taxed in their estate, and their family's paying taxes on money the family doesn't have.
Right.
Or the child could just take it. It's theirs. When you put someone's name on an account as a joint title holder, they can do with that money what they please. It is theirs to have.
So two solutions to that would be maybe a power of attorney for a specific account.
Correct.
Or a transfer on death designation.
A transfer on, I don't recommend the transfer on death designations unless that's the will is where that should be.
Right.
There are some people who like to put transfer of death designations on assets. Sometimes it doesn't matter, but generally keep it simple. Put it in your will who you want to get that asset. Now, but it is a good idea that if you, when you get an agent, a power of attorney, take that power of attorney to the bank so that the bank has a record of that.
Oh,
and
yeah.
If something were to happen, it would state on there, my child, power of attorney.
Oh, yeah. You're not allowed to talk to anybody.
Correct.
About an account if they don't have a power of attorney.
Right. And the banks are very good about that. The privacy rules are... they're pretty strict nowadays. I mean, any doctor could tell you that. It's the
sure.
same way with financial instruments. Yeah.
So what should a power of attorney include? What are the most important features?
There's a general form power of attorney that the state sort of gives you guidelines. There's about 28 different things in there. I mean, just about anything you could think of doing yourself. And mm-hmm. let's leave healthcare out of it because there's
right.
a special document for that. But selling a house, signing checks, getting in the safe deposit boxes, selling stock, buying stock, gifting, which
yeah.
is a big deal. Things like everything you can imagine doing for yourself should be in the power of attorney.
And sometimes people will say, well, I'm only going to give this power of attorney when such and such an event happens.
Sure.
Really, at the time you sign, it's effective.
It's effective when the agent signs it, and what you're talking about is a springing power of attorney, meaning this person becomes my agent when this certain event springs up. A lot of people will say, well, I don't want it to be effective until, for example, if I have Alzheimer's.
Right.
And I can understand that, but the problem, especially with Alzheimer's and dementia, is some days you're okay, some days you're not, and it just becomes too much of a moving target and
yes.
too much of an opportunity for dispute. So that's why I say the person you choose to be your agent has to be someone you trust implicitly. And you can change it. If something
right.
happens, you can change it. But that becomes effective when the agent signs it.
Exactly. So when you look at the idea of springing, is there a way that an attorney can say after a certain amount of time this person gets it, or certain event?
There is, and if the client wants it, if the client would say to the lawyer, look, I don't want the agent signing this power of attorney and making it valid until I'm in a nursing home or until a doctor has declared me
right.
Incompetent, that gets very expensive, and it just opens up the opportunity for too much litigation
right.
In orphans court. And one of the things that estate planning is designed to do is to keep you out of situations like that. It costs a lot of money to go through a guardianship process or any kind of litigation involving competency. And yes, it costs a little bit up front, but you're being penny wise and pound foolish if you have these wishes and don't put them in writing and leave it to chance.
Well, what happens if a person dies intestate? They die, they have no will. Obviously, the state has
right.
some plan because this might have happened.
It does. It's statutory. It's statutory. And one thing people always are afraid of is, well, I have to get something because if I don't die, everything goes to the state. Not
mm-hmm.
true.
Right.
No. It depends on your situation at the time. If you are married, and again, let's back up for a second. This only matters for assets that are not jointly titled. If you don't have a will and every asset you have is jointly titled with your spouse, it doesn't matter. Because upon that death, the joint title holder owns everything. Not a problem. But That's usually not how it works.
Right.
Usually there are retirement accounts, there are life insurance policies, things like that. The state will say this: if you, your assets, your probate assets, the first $30,000 will go to your surviving spouse. Everything after that will be split half to your surviving spouse, the other half really to your children. That's if there's not, if the kids aren't of the same, if they don't have the same mother, first marriage
right.
situations. And that sort of leads to another area, the second marriage situation, which we're seeing more and more of now. When a person is in a second marriage but have children from the first, he or she wants to ensure that when they pass away, not only is the current spouse taken care of, but also the children from the first marriage or second marriage, any of them really. That's why it's so important for the attorney to get in touch with the financial planner to see what assets are out there and how they're titled, because a person might want to take care of the children from the first marriage and the current spouse, but all their assets are titled jointly with the current spouse.
Right.
And then, unbeknownst to them, the children from the first marriage are left out in the cold.
Yes.
And whenever anyone comes in to me, the first thing I will, even before the first meeting, I'll ask them to tell me who your financial advisor is and tell me who your accountant is.
Why does that matter?
It matters because nothing is done in a vacuum. Estate planning is not done in a vacuum. I as the estate planner do not want to mess up anything that is going on with the financial planner or cause tax consequences
right.
To the person because I need to do estate planning for them. And that's why we sort of need to get everybody on the same page.
It helps.
Yeah, and really to get the paperwork from the financial planner as to what assets are out there, how is it titled, so I can sit and analyze and say, okay, what do you want to do? Who do you want to take care of? If you're in a second marriage and you want to take care of your children, mm-hmm. you're going to have to get some of these assets out of joint names, or perhaps you need to go buy life insurance because when you die, everything's going to the spouse.
Right. You brought up the topic of life insurance. One of the things you often see is an irrevocable life insurance trust.
Right.
What is that and why does it matter?
An irrevocable life insurance trust is something, it's a trust. The people who have estates that are subject to the federal estate tax, and there's been a lot of talk about that. Mm-hmm. And one thing the viewers need to understand, there are a lot of different death taxes, but the two main ones are federal estate tax, which for this year is a tax that is imposed on all assets over $2 million. So if you don't have assets over $2 million, that includes life insurance,
mm-hmm.
You're not going to get subject to the federal estate tax.
Right.
There's also Pennsylvania inheritance tax, which is a tax the state imposes really on dollar one for anyone other than the spouse.
Right.
What an irrevocable life insurance trust is, for people who have an estate that is subject to federal estate tax, that are over the $2 million limit, what we try to do for them is, quote, get money out of their estate, meaning when they file the return, we don't want that $1 million, let's say life insurance policy included, so they come under the limit. So what we do is we set up a special vehicle called an irrevocable life insurance trust, wherein the money is paid not to, let's say, the surviving spouse or the children, but to the trust.
Mm-hmm.
But the trust is set up so that the income from that life insurance policy goes to the spouse.
Right.
The spouse has the ability, with conditions, to get some of the principal, and then when that spouse dies, whatever's left goes to the children.
Yes.
And by doing that, you're taking that $1 million out of the estate and really saving yourself, in a lot of cases, hundreds of thousands of dollars. Now,
let's say for the sake of discussion, you have your current assets are worth sure. $2 million, and you have another $1 million life insurance
right.
policy. You'd probably want to have that in irrevocable life insurance trust.
You definitely
right off the bat.
Want, because let's assume you don't have it in the irrevocable life insurance trust.
Right.
You would now have an estate worth $3 million. $2 million of that is going to be exempt. So now you're getting taxed on $1 million at a rate of about 45%. So
right.
that's, you know, do the math, $450,000. Yeah, I wasn't a math major.
Not
but even I know that. But what you could do, if you do the proper planning, is you take that $1 million, you put it into the trust so that when you die, your estate's only worth $2 million. That $1 million will pass outside to the same beneficiaries who are getting under your will, mm-hmm. but you just saved yourself $450,000.
Right.
And, you know, we talk about this limit. In 2011, it's scheduled to go back down to $1 million. And even though, you know, in economic times, people are saying, well, that's a lot of money. You know, the stock market's down. It's not always going to be that way.
Yeah.
You're still going to have a retirement account. You're still going to have life insurance. And you're still going to have property. And if anybody tells you they know what's going to happen, because, we've talked about it and you've heard it. Everyone says, well, they're going to do something about that. Congress is. They're going to raise the limit. Nobody knows.
Right.
The way the economy is today, the federal government, in my opinion, is going to need every dime of revenue they can get. They're not going to just say, okay, we're going to raise the limit to $3.5 or $5 million.
They want your money.
Exactly. And let's face it, nobody knew the stock market crash was coming like it was a year ago. Nobody can say what's going to happen in 3 years. So that's why when we do planning, we have to plan not only for what the limits are today, but reality is we have to act as if it's going to be $1 million in 2011. So it's harder for us, but until we have some certainty, it would be irresponsible not to do that.
Well, so many wills have a bypass trust feature in them.
Right.
And when that limit is flying up and down like crazy, how do you plan that so that the surviving spouse actually has access to their own money?
I generally speak to financial planners and accountants about how to do that. I can set up the trust
right
in the will. And for people who don't understand what a bypass trust is, it's saying, if I'm over the limit and my spouse is still alive, I want part of this money to go into a bypass trust for my spouse, so that when the spouse dies, that money is not included in his or her estate. As far as how that estate gets funded, I generally leave that to the financial planners and accountants. And getting back to what I was saying before, the reason I think I need to work with financial planners and accountants is I'm not an accountant, I'm not a financial planner. I'm not aware of all the intricacies of which assets are best to put into that trust and which ones aren't.
Right.
And if you make the wrong decisions if I were to tell you put this in and put that in without knowing what the tax consequences are down the road, I'd basically be committing malpractice. Yeah. And that's why when it comes to deciding which things go where, I leave that to the experts.
And the world's constantly changing,
sure,
too. I mean, there's so many things. You make your best laid plan from a year ago, looks sort of different today.
And it's not static. The laws are changing all the time, and that's why it's always a good idea to sort of do a checkup every year. Am I sure that the people I want getting these funds are getting them?
Right.
Make an appointment. It's not an easy thing to do. Psychologically, the hardest thing for some people to do is make the appointment and actually think about these things. But you have to do it.
And I think, too, I mean, to be able to go back on a regular basis and say, and just pull out the document yourself and look at it.
Sure.
Also to sit down because the law changes.
Absolutely. Sit down with your attorney, your financial advisor, and look at these things. And even if it is the same thing every year, it's still a good habit to get into, because things change so quickly.
Oh, yeah.
The laws change so quickly. I mean, sometimes we're sending out letters to people as times change saying, what worked a year ago isn't working anymore.
Right.
Let's take a look at this.
So I think estate planning attorneys are going to be especially busy in the next 2 years.
They are. And really, we don't know what's coming as far as the estate tax limit, and that drives a lot of what we do. And keep just one other thing in mind, too. Estate planning is mostly done with the thought of what happens when the second spouse, in a married couple situation, when the second spouse dies. Because in most cases, the surviving spouse is going to get everything. The key is what happens to that when the second spouse dies if there are federal estate tax consequences.
And it's not just that, it's preparing the heirs for what happens when you're suddenly flush with cash.
Right. And you don't want your kids fighting about what dad or mom said. They told me they were going to give me, I'm supposed to get the chairs, no, I'm supposed to get the jewelry.
Yeah.
No, put it in writing, it cuts off all of that. There might be some hurt feelings, but that's the way you want it.
Well, yeah,
it's your estate. You decide how you want to do it.
So many people put off that decision. I don't want to decide who gets the chairs and who gets the lamp, but their idea of estate planning is to shove it off on the beneficiaries.
And, you know, as you and I know, the biggest fights don't come about the big money. It comes about the lamps and the end tables, and that really causes a lot of friction, more than the $100,000 or $200,000.
So you're not doing people a favor by not writing it down.
Not unless you're going to find it amusing after you die to see your heirs at each other's throats, and I don't think many people will do that. But hey, if you're so inclined, the way to do it is to not have estate planning.
I heard of an estate planning attorney who died not leaving a will because he wanted people to be talking about him for several years. It worked.
Well, but I imagine none of those things were good. None of those things that were said
separate
were good.
Issue. So just in the minute we have left, what are the estate tax rates in Pennsylvania?
In Pennsylvania, for a surviving spouse, is zero. If Bill Gates dies tomorrow and leaves everything to his wife, nothing. In Pennsylvania, the estate tax for lineal heirs, 4.5%, siblings is 12, and everybody else, cousins, aunts, uncles, best friends, is 15. Federally, however, it doesn't, unless you're surviving spouse is zero. Mm-hmm. Everybody else gets up to about 45% real quick.
Right. Yeah, it doesn't take long to get to that point.
No, it doesn't, and you don't want to give. Simple estate planning can save you hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Exactly. Well, I appreciate you taking the time to educate the audience on the topic.
Well, thank you for having me.
Our guest has been Eric Fabrizio, who's a partner with Benjamin Hess. I'm Bob Wirt, Managing Director of the Wirt Investment Consulting Group, an affiliate of Wachovia Securities. Thank you for joining us in Berks Business, and we'll look for you again in February when we have our next program.
Business on BCTV is brought to you by Herbine & Company, Incorporated, certified public accountants, accounting for success.